Thank you. Very kind. Thanks for the chance to come back again, drive up to Carlisle, and compare notes with my friends up here. This is going to be interactive before long, so start thinking of questions. The best part of this for me is when we get into our dialogue, but they said I had to give some remarks first, so we're going to go through that. All right. These slides, just to give you some sense as to what this briefing is, all right? I spend a fair amount of time talking to our countrymen. All right, they kind of invite me to say, hey, what keeps you awake at night? All right. I used to say the defensive backfield of the Pittsburgh Steelers. But I'm feeling good this year. I'm feeling really good. The last time I gave these slides, I talked to civilian groups. I talked to our countrymen. All right, and so what I want to do, kind of the format for our talking together here today, is to tell you what I tell them. So it's not just a briefing. It's kind of a little bit of a briefing on a briefing. You know, why I bring these sorts of things up and not those sorts of things up. Okay. The last time I gave this set of slides was in a place called Stadt, Switzerland. They'd say, I've seen some folks nod. Not bad, right? Very good place. Yeah, it was to a group. I've learned these new words in my second life. To a group of what's called high net worth individuals. Okay. And frankly, it was family investment, and I was on the agenda with other folks talking about the global environment. So we had an economist there. We had a Middle East expert there. We had someone talking about Brexit there. This was about 3 weeks before the vote. All right. So that's what this is. So let me share with you what I shared with them, with a, you know, kind of the teacher's guide notes along the way, and then we'll get into a generalized discussion. So I begin with this, and I actually put this first slide up because of the first sentence, right? Because that first sentence actually is true, okay? The way I generally say it is, I'm old enough to remember the world being more dangerous than it is today. Despite all our nervousness, despite 7x24 news coverage, despite the immediacy of getting cell phone video from some unhappy spot on Earth, I've actually lived in more dangerous times. I'm old enough to remember the Cuban Missile Crisis. Okay? I'm old enough to remember Soviet and American armor barrel to barrel at Checkpoint Charlie. And for any of you who've been to Berlin recently, you can't find the damn place anymore. I mean, you know it's here. You're kind of at the right spot, but nothing seems familiar. That's how much things have changed. I'm old enough. I was on active duty. I was a captain when we actually went to DEFCON 3 in 1973 during the Middle East War, when we thought the Soviets were pushing funny weapons through the Bosporus because their Arab allies were about to go down for the count, because the Israelis had an army on the west side of the Suez Canal with nothing between them and Cairo. So I've actually seen it more dangerous. I have never, never seen it more complicated. And the way I generally describe this to our, you know, civilian friends is, if you just kind of picture the Middle East as a fur ball, and I got spikes coming out of the fur ball, I got an ISIS spike and a Nusra spike and a Bashar al-Assad spike and the Iranian spike and the Hezbollah spike, and yeah, I could go on. Right? And I picture myself at some fictitious, cartoonish National Security Council meeting and Susan Rice turning down to the end of the table where the intel guys hide and saying, Hayden, I'm worried about that spike there. Pick one, ISIS. Take care of that ISIS spike. It's really getting scary. Well, my metaphor is, if I go back to Langley and I start pushing down on the ISIS spike and I start to make progress, y'all know what's happening to all the other spikes, right? They're all getting worse. So I've never seen it more complicated. And I'll use a word in the third bullet that I used a minute or two ago. I have actually never seen it more immediate. And here, I'm not just talking about the cell phone video you're going to see tonight on Fox or MS or one of the broadcast networks. And you know you are. You know, you're going to see some unhappy video from somewhere. I mean, that's immediate. But I mean beyond that. I mean, actually, when something goes bump here, There are substantial and measurable and sometimes immediate effects here. Just to play out one, so I got this terrorism civil war thing going on in Syria. It goes on too long. It leads to migration, leads to the destabilization of the European community, and the United Kingdom leaves the EU. And actually, those dots aren't very far apart, right? Because of the tremendous interconnectedness of today's world. So more dangerous, yes. Never more complicated, never more immediate. Okay, so generally what I try to do is not follow the shiny silver object or to predict what it actually is we're going to see tonight on our favorite 7x24. I could fill up the space today between us talking about any one of these mopes up here. You know, the fun-loving Kim family from North Korea up there at 3 o'clock, Vladimir Vladimirovich, Anonymous, and so on. And frankly, that probably wouldn't be a bad use of our time and probably be pretty interesting, but I don't think it's the best use of our time. So rather than following the headline, or worse yet, trying to predict the headline, what I have done now for the last couple of years, and I keep it updated, so I don't want you to think this is aging in the cellar, all right, along with the Pinot and the Cabernet. I actually open the bottle and freshen it every now and again. What I've defaulted to is what I call tectonics, okay? And what I'm going to spend our time today talking about are four or five tectonics. And you might wonder, well, how many do you have, Hayden, four or five? When I get to the fifth, you'll understand why I'm saying kind of four or five, all right? Here's tectonic one. And I'm going to spend more time on this one, so don't be alarmed. We're going to get done in time, all right? I'll speed through the rest. But this one is really a big deal. So you know who that is behind me there, right? That's Brent Scowcroft, one of the greatest strategic minds this country has ever created. He was National Security Advisor not once, but twice. National Security Advisor for Ford and National Security Advisor for Bush 41. So about 4 years ago now, Brent writes an article for the Atlantic Council. I read him, man, this is really interesting. I used to work for Brent. I was on 41's NSC staff. So I read the article from General Scowcroft and go, this really got a lot of thought in here. So I make my way over to Farragut Square in DC to Scowcroft Associates. And the general always got time for folks who's worked for him. And I sat down and said, I read your article. It's really interesting. And so what I'm going to tell you now is not just what's in the article, but what he elaborated in the conversation. So in essence, what he says is, look, when I was doing my thing, all the pieces on the board that I cared about were nation states. And the way I moved the pieces around was through what you and I call hard power. And I explain that to civilians, hard power, masses of men and metal at the right place at the right time. And if we liked you, the promise, if we didn't like you, the threat of masses of men and metal. So nation states, hard power. And what Brent says in the Atlantic article, Atlantic Council article, is that neither of those two sentences are as true as they were when he was doing his thing. And he references in the conversation with me, he references that I was doing my thing, he says, at the height, Ford, and the back end, 41, of the industrial era. Okay? So bear with me, okay? It's going to sound a little bit more like a civics or a history class rather than a current intelligence briefing, but it's really important. What Brent suggests that in the industrial era, most things flowed to the center. That's true, but that's not the best way of explaining it. Let me flip that. In the industrial era, you couldn't be somebody without an empowered center, right? You could not be a disorganized whole and be an industrial power. To be an industrial power, you needed the strong attributes of a powerful nation state to create the conditions for industrial strength. Okay. The Republicans remembered for their first president, Abraham Lincoln, and historically remembered for the core plank in their platform, which was emancipation. But it wasn't the only plank in the platform. They actually had and we're going to build the national infrastructure plank in the platform too, because we're going to be an industrial power. And if you go down the road and visit Gettysburg and go through the wonderful visitor center down there, you will see that in addition to the issue of slavery, there was also an issue about the economic future of the United States. In other words, going from a largely agrarian society, which the South wanted to remain, to an industrial society, which the Northeast wanted us to become. And with the Republicans broadly in control of government for the rest of the 19th century, we built the infrastructure, sweetheart deals with the railroads and so on, that allowed America to burst onto the international scene at the beginning of the 20th century as the new industrial power. Communism, bad theory of history, even worse theory of government. Not bad if what it is you want to do is to centralize power to rapidly industrialize a backward, agrarian, near-feudal society. Okay, so industrial era, empowerment to the center. I generally tell civilian audiences, I'm old enough to remember when making a phone call was such a complicated undertaking that we used to entrust it only to a government or a government-controlled monopoly. Remember? And the last thing any of us in this room want is to have to depend upon the federal government for our text messages to go forward somewhere, right? Okay. In other words, we went from an era in which complicated things could only be done by centralized power to an era because of our leaving the industrial age to the post-industrial, interconnected, information-based web, keep filling in the blank, era. As the industrial era accrued power to the center in order to get anything done, this post-industrial era pushes power down and out. I'm old enough to remember I used to have to get in a car, drive to a building, get out of the car, walk into another building, and talk to a human being to get my money. I can't remember the last time I did that. By the way, when I do that in college campuses, I kind of get money. I mean, it's the square and the swipe, and it's all digital, right? In my old line of work, I'm old enough to remember only two nations used to take pictures from space, and only one of them did it well. And if you want, after lecture, go on to Google Earth and you will pull up imagery of sufficient resolution of North Korea to decide on yourself, by yourself, whether or not they are stacking a Taepodong missile for potential launch. Okay? As the industrial era accrued power to the center, the post-industrial era pushes power down to groups, gangs, and even individuals. One more, I'm old enough to remember, I never lost any sleep over a religious fanatic living in a cave in the Hindu Kush. And we do. So do you get the point, all right? It's not just power down, it's also interconnectivity, right? In a longer form of this, I actually show pictures of the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria. And then, of course, ask the audience, I suppose you're wondering why the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria are in the current intelligence briefing. And in essence, all I do is say, that was the last great age of globalization. Okay? Any of you been to that wonderful maritime museum in San Diego, out there in the harbor, it's on two or three ships? Yeah, spectacular museum. I'm walking through there about three summers ago with my wife, and I come upon this display, the Great Age of Sail. And what it says is 500 years ago, our species, okay, in the Great Age of Sail, launched largely from Europe, out to interconnect the entire globe, to pull together, to link societies that and civilizations that have been gathering steam individually in their own track, but suddenly link them together, and then they go to the punchline, and thereby created the greatest explosion of human learning and commerce in recorded history up to that time. Also gave us global piracy, the global slave trade, and global epidemics. Okay, we gave the North Americans pox, they gave European syphilis. And that was interconnectivity at 12 knots an hour with a favoring wind. And you and I now, remember, power down, and interconnected at 186,000 miles per second. So we get this. which in terms of what could go bump tonight, these are my prime candidates. And in one way, I mean, I know they're different, but you understand they're not. I mean, I know that they are a different face, but you realize they are the product of the same phenomenon of powering down and interconnectedness. Now, I get it. Any of those can be used by a nation state for nation state purposes, right? But you got to admit, none of them require a nation state for them to actually create great harm. In other words, what I'm trying to suggest to you, the big tectonic number one, frankly, the tectonic has been sucking your energy and your brains for the last 15 years since we've been at war, right? Is how do we deal with dangers of a degree we formerly associated only with malevolent state power? How do we deal with dangers of that magnitude now coming at us from non-state, sub-state actors? That is the most basic tectonic that's affecting our national security. I'm going to go into this a little bit further. I told you I spent a lot of time on tectonic one. Let me go into a part of this that I don't do for all general audiences, but I'm going to do for this one because of who we are in this room. You realize, right, that all of our national security establishment has been hardwired in 1947 to defend us against malevolent state power. Right? We took the lessons of the last great war of the industrial era and self-organized to fight it again. The National Security Act of 47 created the JCS, CIA, the National Security Council, the Secretary of Defense, and America's Air Force. We are hardwired as a country to go this way against threats coming down that pike, nation states. And most of the arguments we've been having with ourselves and most of the adjustments you've been having to make in the last 15 years are fundamentally taking a national security structure designed to go this way and make it go this way to defend us against this new group, this new class, this sub-state state actor. We are probably furthest along, as prickly as it is, we are probably furthest along figuring out how we want to fight terrorism with the structure. We haven't even begun to figure out how we want to do that one, okay? And this one, I do not want to suggest, as a former director of the Central Intelligence Agency, that we've worked out all the prickly spots in terms of how we fight terrorism. In the long form, the public audiences, I kind of do a little stage play here, kind of a one-man show. I say, you know, we've had two presidents quite different in personality. Both say we're at war with Al-Qaeda. I mean, no fooling. Formal war. Belligerent. Armed conflict. Laws of armed conflict apply. Right? Otherwise, we don't get to do that stuff that both presidents have you and me doing. Right? All right? So we are in armed conflict. So in my one-man show cartoonish version, I go, okay, I get it, Mr. President. We are at war with Al-Qaeda. I'm going to close with and destroy the enemy. That's what we do in all of our wars. What's that technically mean, Hayden? Technically, it means we're going to go kill them. Chateau Theory, down the road here at Gettysburg, Iwo Jima, Incheon. That's all we've done in our wars. We've done that in all of our wars. What's it look like over here? It looks like targeted killings from unmanned aerial vehicles outside of internationally agreed theaters of conflict. At that point, my fictitious national security policymaker type goes, whoa, slow down, Hayden. Make me a little nervous here. What else you got in your kit bag for this nation at war? I go, well, we've captured people in every conflict. We had hundreds of thousands of Axis prisoners here in North America during World War II. There's a graveyard at Fort Meade of German soldiers who died of natural causes while they were interned at Fort Meade. Okay, yeah, capturing. What's that look like? Looks like Guantanamo. All right, Hayden, you make me nervous now. I'm backing away from the capturing and killing thing. What else you got in your bag? I said, well, I could do that espionage thing. I could do the intelligence approach. I got it. I could try to intercept their communications. You know, I saw the movie, you know, Bletchley Park, Enigma, Purple, Battle of Midway. What's that look like? Looks like the 215 program, 702, Stellar Wind, and a whole bunch of things Edward Snowden's told you about for the last 2 years. Do you see? Sorry, I told you I was being cartoonish, but you get the point? Okay? We've got tools, but they were optimized for and validated for this kind of use. Now, we all have done the adjustment as to how we could use them over here, and we have, but the validation, the legitimization, the public acceptance, kind of lagging a little bit behind. Tectonic One, all right? Tectonic One has to do with empowerment down and interconnectivity, creating a completely new flavor of threat to which we are only now adjusting. Okay, that's one. Tectonic Two, and like I said, I'll speed up here. Tectonic Two, things that seemed permanent actually aren't. Now, if you take a look at these maps, the one on the left, you know that's not right. That's a map of Europe just 100 years ago, and all those empires are gone. Now look at the one on the right. That's the one you grew up with. Me too. That's no more accurate than the one on the left. There are entities on that map that you and I, you know, that's the map you and I stared at in algebra class when we were not lucky enough to be sitting in the row by the windows where we could look outside while the teacher was trying to explain the solution to a polynomial equation. We had to stare at this map to get out of that zone. Okay? And frankly, if you're like me, I kind of thought like that's the map. That's Europe. That's what it looks like. Except, you know, there are at least three entities up there and counting based upon last week's events. Three entities up there that no longer exist. Czechoslovakia, Velvet Divorce, Czech Republic, Slovak Republic. Yugoslavia, land of the South Slavs, divorced, nothing velvety, 250,000. Many of you probably served Bosnia or Kosovo or Macedonia or Croatia. Nothing velvety about the divorce. 250,000 people died. Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, now not created by Versailles, which created Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia, but created at the same time as Versailles. Okay? And then if you take that a little bit to the east and look a little bit more at what was created by Versailles, and you look at some of the countries listed up there, Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Libya. Let me fast forward. They don't exist. And they're never going to exist again. They aren't coming back. I'm fond of pointing out that the only organized military force in the patch of land we used to call Iraq fighting on behalf of what it was we used to call Iraq are the 4,200 Americans. No other organized fighting force is fighting for a vision of Iraq. They are fighting for a slice of what we used to call Iraq. Syria disintegrated. I know of no political model that allows the Sunni population to rejoin a state in which the Alawites even exist, let alone govern. The government of Lebanon has been functional for a couple of years. It is a remarkable reflection on the quality of Lebanese society that things still go on. And I think you know as much about Libya as I do. And there is no government there. I was up in Baltimore. It's 2 or 3 months ago now. The Republicans were having an offsite. It was Republican congressional members. So you had the members of the House and the members of the Senate. They come back into town early from a recess. They go up to Baltimore on a Sunday, stay Sunday and Monday night, and then they go back to D.C. For Tuesday. Baltimore's close enough. You know, you don't create extra travel challenges. Baltimore's close enough that the family can kind of come with you. All right? So they have this day and a half seminar where they just get everyone in the room, senators and House members, and have panels. All right? You know, an economic panel, other kind of national issues panels. I got invited to go up there and be on the national security panel. Okay? I was there with Mike Chertoff, former Secretary of Homeland Security, Ray Odierno, who had just left his position as Chief of Staff, Ryan Crocker, who I noticed in the book, I don't know if he was here for you, but he was? Okay. Yeah, he was just here. All right. Ryan's a wonderful diplomat. We have made him the ambassador to every ugly spot on earth. Okay. He was our ambassador to Pakistan. He was our ambassador to Iraq. Okay. So you had Chertoff, Odierno, Crocker, me, and Robert Kagan. Okay. Robert Kagan, Brookings, very thoughtful, solid geopolitical analyst. So we're there. Republicans are far more unruly than you are, all right? We got a moderator and a panel, yada, yada, yada. They're yelling questions. They're going back. I mean, it's just, you know, it got very interactive very early. And finally, Kagan just said, stop. Look, here's what's happening. We are seeing the melting down, the going away, of the post-World War II American liberal Bretton Woods World Bank IMF world order. Get it? In other words, that global solution that's pretty much crafted by American hands, that global solution to keep global order at the height of the industrial era has run out of steam. And we're seeing the melting down of the post-World War II Bretton Woods American liberal international order. Now, I didn't say it at the time, okay, but I'm telling you, that's only the half of it. We're not seeing just the melting down of the post-World War II order. Check the map. We are seeing the melting down of the post-World War I order as well, because all these lines were drawn after at Versailles. And then, let me triple down. We're seeing the melting down of this, too. Okay, this is the Treaty of Westphalia, 1648, ended the 30 Years' War in Europe. It is the treaty that ended the last great religious war in Christendom. Okay. After 1648, Europeans generally believed that they had plenty enough reasons to kill one another. They didn't have to keep religion on the list. And so this is, by the way, most historians in our culture, in our civilization, date Europe going modern from 1648. It's the end of the empires, the beginning of the nation states, the separation of the sacred and the secular, the separation of the coercive power of the state from questions of theology. Big deal. We all thought that was a settled question because Europeans then exported the Westphalian model in the great age of imperialism to the rest of the planet. The rest of the planet, particularly one of the other great monotheisms, Islam, is saying, not so fast. And what is going on in the Middle East, that red blob there, the caliphate, is fundamentally not just challenging the borders post-Versailles. You all know that's Sykes-Picot, right? Okay. Not just challenging the borders post-Versailles, it's challenging the Western concept as to how the globe should be organized into secular nation states. I was at Hay on Wye, which is just on the border of Wales outside of England, about a month ago. They have a wonderful literary festival there. And I went there as part of the book. I got interviewed. It was great. But so good. My wife and I spent 3 days there. We went to everything we possibly could. And we went to this one lecture. I wish I remember the guy's name. He was magnificent. And he was talking about the history of Europe in the 17th century. And he began by saying, you know, when a European went out in 1600 and looked at the stars and saw what we see, he knew that was the vault of heaven. And that those moves in circular orbits around him, because, of course, Earth was the center of that universe. A European goes out in 1700. He looks at the same stars, and he thinks Newton and Kepler and orbital mechanics and the Earth moving through space. And a whole bunch of things changed in between, including the 30 Years' War and the Treaty of Westphalia and the Enlightenment and so on. So he lays us all out. It was this fascinating lecture. And we get to the Q&A. Professor, is there any similarity between what's going on in the Middle East today and with what Europe underwent in the 17th century? He goes, yes, it's identical. Now, I'm overstating that only a little bit. But fundamentally, what he is saying is Islam is now going through the grand debate that Christendom went through in the 17th century about the relationship between faith and reason, about the relationship between religion and power. And we in the West came up with an answer. We call it modernity. We separated them. That's a point. That's not a trend line. There is no guarantee that this other great monotheism, remember, we all came out of the same desert. We all looked to Abraham. We were all people of the book. There is no guarantee that our cousins in this other great monotheism come up with the same answer that Westphalia did. So, sorry, the second tectonic took a little time too. But it is the melting down of things we took as given. Remember that polynomial I told you about that you didn't pay any attention to like I didn't? Okay? That polynomial had constants and variables. And the sneaky trick is this polynomial, the thing we thought were constants, turned out they're variables. Damn. Okay. By the way, just so you don't think that this redo of Westphalia is purely Islamic, look at the mope in the top right-hand corner. Okay. Now, I know that as a nasty thing it did in Crimea. Even worse, what he's doing in the eastern Ukraine. All right, I was in the Baltics about 3 weeks ago. They're all kind of focused on them too. Okay, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania. Right? I mean, moving lines in Europe is really a bad idea. Okay. But underneath that is something even worse. The Westphalian definition of citizenship, remember we created nation states, right? The Westphalian definition of citizenship is, hey, if you live in X, you're an Xer. Vladimir Vladimirovich is added a codicil. Your nationality, in addition to your residency, might also be determined by the language your mom and dad spoke in the kitchen while you were growing up. In other words, he feels not just the right, but the responsibility to defend Russian speakers wherever they might be. That's as corrosive of the Westphalian compromise as anything going on in Raqqa. Okay? So tectonic two, fundamental shifts in the global order. All right, I can speed now. More familiar stuff. Whoa. Tectonic three, states ambitious, fragile, nuclear. I guess what I'm trying to say to you is there's more of this stuff out there. Okay? And so the more there is out there, the greater the probability that it's mishandled, misused, or simply lost. Let me give you a couple of states that are fit this definition. You got these guys, of course. All right. I served two tours in Korea. My last tour, I actually was our negotiator at Panmunjom with the North Korean People's Army. You know, I cannot imagine the amount of cognitive dissonance that must have been in the head of Yi Chang-bok, who was my North Korean counterpart. I mean, for him to say and believe the things he had to say and believe, how much of reality did he have to suppress inside of his own mind. I'm often asked, so what are these guys' foreign policy or security policy? And I say, well, it's kind of like a shampoo bottle. Okay. Provoke, accept concessions, repeat. And if you've noticed, you know, it's just not this. Look up here. It's not this. It's this. Provocations are getting more serious. So, a danger. These guys, I thought we were done with this. I spent a quarter century of my professional life trying to balance their nuclear forces. I mean, I'm looking around seeing people of much younger age. You didn't have to do this at all. You know, is a multiple independently targeted warheaded ICBM more or less stabilizing than a single warhead? I mean, it was like theology in terms of getting to the right calculus of what constituted deterrence. I thought that was all history. And now you actually have these guys turning the pages back. Their exercises, boy, I got an earful of this in the Baltics. Their exercises are blending in nuclear use. And they're blending in nuclear first use. Because unlike the Cold War, they're actually weaker conventionally than the West is if we ever get our act together. Right? By the way, they call nuclear first use at the tactical level a de-escalatory step. Now, you've read the doctrine. It freezes the conflict. I mean, de-escalatory as in, and then we don't lose. Okay? That picture there, that says Sochi in the top left, that's a kind of a Russian equivalent National Security Council meeting where RT or other Russian networks kind of come in and do the B-roll as the Siloviki get in and sit in their chairs. That is a picture of a slide that was left out. It is a nuclear torpedo of 6,000 kilometers range and megatonnage warhead capacity. It is a literal doomsday machine. Okay. Now, I have no idea if there is anything at all behind that view graph. But by the way, the Russians, oh God, what a slow, that should have never been on TV. Okay. Yeah. But the fact that they wanted to show that, and they wanted us to see that, I mean, suggests kind of this place that I thought was kind of in our past is in our present and maybe in our future. Of course, the Iranians, our country spent an awful lot of political and diplomatic capital getting to a deal with the Iranians. The things on the right are kind of the main tenets of the deal. Okay. I could actually fill up our time saying, not so fast, I'm not so sure, but we're not going to do that. I'm going to accept the deal as the deal. I'm going to tell you the deal's great. The deal works. They aren't going to cheat. Oh, I'm sorry. Of course they're going to cheat, but they're not going to cheat in any way that really matters. Okay, we're going to get what that deal promises. Okay, you got that? That's my premise. Accept the premise. Now let me give you my conclusion. Because the deal works, in 10 to 12 years, Iran will be an industrial strength nuclear power never more than 3 weeks away from enough fissile material for a nuclear weapon. That's the outcome of the successful deal. Sorry, this is a crowded chart. This is put out by something called the Fund for Peace. It is something that they used to call the Failed States Index. The failed states apparently complained. and it's now called the States Under Stress Index. And as you can see, you got categories across the top. All right. In essence, what they're trying to do is judge how brittle or elastic is a state. How stable or instable might a state be? So you've got demographic pressures, refugees, group grievances, human flight. And it's pretty scientific. I mean, it's not math, but it is disciplined, all right? And so they go through each of those categories every year and score each state in each, I think there are a dozen categories, all right? And they give them a numerical score, and then they add them up. And they rack and stack from 1 to 171, who is more or less stable. If you're curious, our homeland is in the mid-20s from the good side of the chart, okay? We get marked down for distribution of wealth, and failed political processes. I do point out, so we're 24, 23, somewhere in that rank, but who wants to live in Finland, right? I said that in a talk about 2 months ago, and the American ambassador to Finland came up to me afterwards. We digress. That's the wrong end of the chart. That's a good end. This is a bad end. I call your attention to number 10, tucked comfortably between Haiti and Zimbabwe. Is the Islamic Republic of Pakistan with 120 nuclear weapons, and at this moment, creating more nuclear weapons than any other country on the planet. Tectonic 3, a lot of stuff out there, and it's stuff that appears to be going to increasingly unstable hands. Okay, Tectonic 4, again, back to more traditional stuff, more familiar stuff for you. This, the rise of the People's Republic of China. So let me tell you what I've been saying to those civilian audiences now for 7.5 years, actually longer. I used to say this while I was in government. These guys are not our enemy. There aren't any good reasons for them to become our enemy. There are logical, non-heroic policy choices available to us and the Chinese that keep the relationship competitive. Oh, God, yeah. Occasionally confrontational? Yeah. Never has to get to the level of conflict. And then I go on to say, people like me, and by the way, I've checked. I just kind of talked to people like me. People like me spend more time worrying about Chinese failure than we do Chinese success, fretting and wringing our hands more about Chinese weakness than we do Chinese strength. Look, these guys have pulled off an absolute miracle. They have dragged 400 million people into a genuine middle-class existence in a generation and change. That is just awesome. But despite that great success, there are structural issues within the People's Republic that, number one, is going to make it harder to sustain that growth, and number two, there are issues that are actually going to chew at the foundation of that growth. What do I mean? Top left, pollution. Let me change that. Environmental catastrophe. I'm a fellow at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. The U.S. Chamber estimates these guys lose about 10% of GDP a year to environmental degradation. Okay. They've got a demographic pyramid with the point on the wrong end, the product of one-child policy for two or three generations. If you think your Social Security system is a Ponzi scheme, imagine what a Chinese citizen must feel. I hadn't thought about this before, but a good friend of mine, Victor Chang, who does a lot of work on China, came to my class at George Mason and added another thought about the one-child policy. You realize this is a society without brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, or cousins? And I think I know what that means if that were happening in America, where our family structure is fairly nuclear. I'm really curious as to what that now means to China, where the family structure has always historically been far more extended. You've got horrible maldistribution of wealth. I mean, we get knocked down for it. These guys are off the chart. Any of you have been to China? You've been to the coast? Looks like us. You go inland? Looks like China. 300-400 years ago, all right? It really does, all right? So there are great issues. There's another issue, too. That guy in the lower left-hand corner with our president, that's Xi Jinping. The irreverent question I asked is, who died and made him emperor? No, he's the president of the People's Republic. Maybe that's my half-assed way of asking, what is the legitimacy of Chinese communist rule? Well, historically, the legitimacy of Chinese Communist Party rule for the last several years, several decades, several generations, has had nothing to do with Marx, Engels, Lenin, or even Mao. It has not been ideologically based. It's been based on my left arm, which is my crude depiction of Chinese GDP growth over that 15 or 20 year period when they created 400 million members of the middle class. Most people who study China think my arm is a little too high. And everyone who studies China knows my hand is in the wrong place. Okay. This is middle income trap. The game that got them here can't get their game to the next level. I can throw out all sorts of macroeconomic phrases. But fundamentally, right, that growth cannot continue. It cannot continue within the current structure of Chinese society. And so you've got this social contract where the party says to the citizens, hey, we're going to be autocratic, but don't sweat it. You're going to be rich. And now if the party can't fulfill the back end of the social contract, how do they get to continue to be autocratic? That's back to the macro. I worry more about these guys failing than I do succeeding. And how they get to continued legitimacy if they can't deliver on this astronomical economic growth is something we've seen before in history. And that's just to fall back on raw nationalism. I've got a few examples up here. That's a Chinese fighter doing a barrel roll in front of a Navy P-8. They've taken to do that pretty regularly against rivet joint and the P-8 fleet. Lower left is called the 9-dash line. That is the extent of Chinese territorial claims in the South China Sea. From their point of view, they get to treat that body of water the way you and I get to treat Lake Michigan. Top right, sandcastles being built in the South China Sea to give a little more reality to the historic claims of the 9-dash line. I, in my last two jobs, the CIA and NSA job, I had a lot of insight into Chinese thinking and about, you know, the diplomatic stuff. God, they're good. I mean, sophisticated, patient, nuanced, historical. I mean, I had a lot of time to read their stuff. Okay. And then they declare an air defense identification zone over a bunch of rocks in the East China Sea one Saturday morning. Remember the ideas over the Senkakus about 3 years ago? That is so untypically Chinese in terms of how they have handled most of these things. And then they're making these incredibly aggressive claims in the South China Sea, driving any nation who borders the South China Sea into our open arms. Because of Chinese behavior, you know, the Koreans aren't complaining very much about the 2ID, Osan, or Daegu, or Kunsan, right? Okay, occasionally I get Okinawans complaining about F-18 jet noise in Okinawa, but fundamentally, we're not leaving. The Philippines welcoming us back. We got littoral combat ships homeported in Singapore. I've got a Marine company building to a battalion, building to a regiment at Darwin in the northern part of Australia. And frankly, the Vietnamese are saying, where the hell did you guys go? Which, if I'm a Chinese diplomat, is all bad. And yet, I do think they've got this pressure on them for legitimacy to kind of wrap that cloak of nationalism around them. Graham Allison is a professor up at Harvard. Graham has been an assistant secretary of this or that a couple of times, I think, in defense. And then he goes back to Harvard and writes a book about it. I'm trying to be complimentary. He's very smart, and he's got practical experience. Graham has written about this phenomenon. He has written about what he calls the status quo power, that's us, dealing with the emerging power. And he kind of pulls the thread throughout history and says, you know, how those poor people in Sparta had to deal with those people with a bad attitude over in Athens. And he plays it forward into the modern era and says, in the modern era, kind of that age of sail thing, the last 500 years, in the modern era, Graham says, we have seen this phenomenon, an emerging power, status quo power, about 24 times. And the challenge is to get from the old equilibrium, pre-emergence, to the new equilibrium, post-emergence. He says, by the way, we always do it. We always get there. He does say, unfortunately, in about 2 out of 3 cases historically, the mechanism by which we get from the old equilibrium to the new equilibrium goes by the popular name global war. And so Graham's point is, this is a really big deal. And frankly, I agree. This other stuff on the board is really important. This one, I think, is pass-fail. And remember where I began. These guys are not our enemy. But working with them and occasionally against them to craft a resolution of a new equilibrium that fairly accommodates the fact that they are a rising power, I think is the most serious challenge the American statecraft has. So that's 4. And I teased you before, I said I got 4 or 5, right? And then I said, I'll tell you why I can't figure out my number. Here's why. You're number 5. In other words, so what the hell are you guys going to do about this? Not you guys here, the 320 million you guys. If I were not the former head of CIA, if I were, say, the former head of DGSE, and this was not the Army War College, but L'École Militaire, and I was talking to you about tectonics, this would be on my list, and it would not be number 5. What it is we think our role is in this emerging world is one of the most fundamental tectonics we have to deal with. And in our case, to create or not create. Now, it's really hard for the intel guy to talk about blue. And so what I do in this part of the presentation is just default to an American scholar, Walter Russell Mead, whose work is always really interesting, even we don't always agree with it. Mead says there are 4 models, historical models, for American national security policy. And these 4 models he can associate with one of 4 historic figures. He said, you know, you can organize the American approach to the rest of the planet along Hamiltonian lines. Besides being the play, he was also the Secretary of the Treasury, right? Okay. I can't get tickets. The first available tickets is January of next year for the play. Anybody, I'm going to be in New York Wednesday. If any of you know somebody, let me know. Hamiltonian foreign policy. America cannot be free unless America is prosperous. America cannot be prosperous unless America is strong. Mitt Romney would have been a Hamiltonian president. I can almost guarantee it because that thing I just did, he said in one of the debates 4 years ago with President Obama when asked to explain his foreign policy. Hamiltonian foreign policy. Wilsonian, American idealism, the war to end all wars, the war to make the world safe for democracy. We've got a better idea. It's just not for North American use. We need to repackage it and be its agent spread throughout the world. Free peoples, free markets, free ideas. American idealism, Wilsonian foreign policy. Jefferson, 3rd president of the United States. Now, I know he bought Louisiana, and he actually waged our first war in North Africa. Right? All that said, Jefferson was very inward-turning. Jefferson was, none of that stuff here. We got plenty to do here. We've got to build our own shining city on the hill. During Jefferson's terms, there was an undeclared naval war taking place off of New England and off of Hampton Roads. We weren't in it. It was between the French and the British. But they were both grabbing our merchantmen and our sailors. And of course, you know, we're kind of a teenage country. We're kind of, hey, what are you going to do about this? You know, we're getting dissed by the Europeans here. Do something about these predations on American commerce. And so Jefferson's answer was to have Congress pass a series of laws called, I don't think this was a good idea then or now, but the series of laws called the Non-Intercourse Acts, which gave Jefferson the authority to direct American merchant ships to stay in port. How are you going to handle the predations of the British and the French Navy off of Hampton Roads? Easy. We're not going there. Jefferson, inward turning. So, Wilson idealism, Hamiltonianism, commercial-based. Jefferson, inward turning. Jackson, man of the frontier, man of the people. First Democrat, doesn't matter whether you spell that with a big D or little D, he is the first Democrat. War hero, Indian fighter. Meade's summation of Jacksonian foreign policy is, or the kind of thoughts that form Jacksonian foreign policy, is succinct and to the point. He says, you know, kind of like the people who watch Fox News. Okay. My words now, not his, a foreign policy organized around Robert De Niro's immortal line in Taxi Driver. You talking to me? President I serve, President Bush, was Wilsonian. I used to sit in the Oval. This is not me thinking back on my sitting in the Oval. This is me telling you what I was thinking when I was sitting in the Oval. Okay, when you, after you do your thing, you kind of get to withdraw a little bit. You kind of watch. Can't be too distracted. Can't stand. What do you think, Mike? Don't know, Mr. President. Wasn't following that one. Not a good answer. But you do have, you know, you can preserve one part of one lobe to kind of observe what you're doing in addition to playing. And at the time, I swear, I had the thought, this has got to be the most Wilsonian guy in this room since Wilson. More than a little Jackson going on there, too. Okay? I wasn't there, but I saw the B-roll, and I have talked to someone who was there. The president was getting off the helicopter, Marine One on the South Lawn. My memory's clouded, but I think it was a Sunday, so he's probably coming back from Camp David. All the man wanted to do was get to his house. And of course, he's walking from Marine One on the South Lawn, past the rope line of the press. Rah, 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 they're barking questions at him. And he's just walking. And suddenly someone barks, "What about that insurgency in Iraq, Mr. President? It's looking pretty bad." He stops, he pivots, turns, steps, points, and says, "Bring it on, Jackson." If you are a combination of Wilson and Jackson, you could be leaning a little forward in your foreign policy. President Obama, I think, is equally Wilsonian. Listen to the speech in Cairo, listen to the speech in Ankara. For God's sake, pull a copy of the speech in Prague, where he actually seriously proposed we're going to go build a world without any nuclear weapons. You can't get much more Wilsonian than that, given the global situation. I think also the president's got a lot of Jefferson going on there, too. Otherwise, you don't get the tide of wars receding, Al-Qaeda's on the run, and it's time to do some nation building here at home. Remember that speech at West Point, December 2009, the Afghan surge speech? Yeah, that was going to go on about 8 o'clock Eastern time. So I figured, okay, long speech, treadmill in the basement, turn the TV on, get 5 miles in, and watch the speech. So I did. I watched the speech on the treadmill. He got the one part of the speech, damn near kill myself. He got the word Afghanistan, good war, necessary war, surge, 12 to 15 months in the same sentence. And I think I don't have to overdraw the lesson for this audience. Getting surge and time limit into the same speech, let alone the same sentence, is an inner Wilson struggling with an inner Jefferson. Okay. So, your turn. You get to vote. You get to choose. How could you go wrong? Great quote from David Rothkopf. The way I tell the civilian audience is, you know, there may be some people think this is a good idea. There may be other people say, no. This is a good idea. Can we all agree that this really is a bad idea? And this has been American policy for the last 16 years. And so, I mean it, you get to shape the last tectonic. What is it you think our nation's appropriate role in this world in which foundational things are shifting? What do you think we ought to be doing? Okay, time's up. Questions?
Sir, Nancy McCoy, Seminar 15. My question goes to your initial tectonic shift and non-state actors. So the Geneva Convention's common articles inform us as to the treatment of POWs in interstate and intrastate situations. And I wonder if you think it speaks to us about how the treatment of prisoners of war in a transnational, belligerent, non-state actor mode, if it can help us with that, or if not, if it needs to be reconsidered.
Yeah, our problem is that Geneva is written in accordance with categories that have been overridden, eroded, or blended. And so Al Gonzalez, who's a good friend of mine, unfortunately once said Geneva was quaint. All right, that's not how I would start the public debate on this. But I do think Geneva drops us in the categories that simply do not... Geneva drops us into categories which, if we applied them literally, our government could not fulfill its moral obligations to defend the nation. And so I've actually said this to international lawyers, and they kind of agree. And I said, so how do you change it? And one of the answers is accepted international practice. All right, which is I'm seeing some folks obviously know the law nodding. Yeah, although this, I mean, for example, international law outlaws espionage, but everyone who agreed to that was spying at the time. And therefore, accepted international practice is that espionage is a legitimate state activity. Right? So now you've got Geneva, combatant, non-combatant, belligerent, non-belligerent, state, non-state. How do we do this? And one way is you simply create new precedent. And so then I say to the international lawyer, so how do you do that? And the answer is, do it. And so we are. All right, we're trying. And again, thanks for asking. I'm going to go a little long on your answer here, okay? I take great pains in the book to point out that we may do a lot of things that other people disagree with, okay? That people who might think it was not lawful, according to Geneva. But we do not do things that are lawless. Okay? It is based on a different interpretation or a necessary adjustment based upon the realities. I'll give you one. Targeted killings. Right? Remember, outside of internationally agreed theaters of conflict. Yeah. Let me tell you how many other countries agree with the American theory on targeted killings. Israel. Maybe Great Britain. Because they actually killed a British citizen in Syria about 6 months ago. I actually think it is absolutely consistent with international law. I was at the German embassy in May of 2007. I've been director of CIA for about 12 months. And Ambassador Sherwood was in the chair. The Germans were in the chair of the EU. Sherwood was the German ambassador to the US. So he had the EU bubbas over for lunch every 2 weeks. So the ambassadors from the EU states to the United States, to the German residents for lunch. And they talk Euro things, but they'd have an American come in occasionally to be kind of the entertainment. And so I was brought in, and I said, hey, I'm director of CIA. These are our friends. Let's have an honest discussion. So I decided to talk about renditions, detentions, and interrogations. Yeah, it ended pretty much the way you thought. And about two or three pages in, and I had a great staff, they wrote great, but I did a lot of this one myself. About two or three pages in, I said, look, cards face up. Let me tell you what I believe, my agency believes, my government believes, and I believe my country believes. I actually said something about this is America, not just Texas. Okay? I said, we are a nation at war. We are at war with Al-Qaeda and its affiliates. This war is global in scope, and I can only fulfill my legal and moral responsibilities under that reality by taking this fight to that enemy wherever they may be. War, Al-Qaeda, global, take the fight. No other nation in the room agreed with any of those four sentences. They not only rejected them for themselves, they thought the American legal theory was unfounded and was simply wrong. It's 9 years later now. I'm telling you, they're wrong, we're right. Okay? But they've not yet accepted that increased in that international practice based upon an adherence to law, but its application in very, very unique circumstances. So I could go on. I could do this for Guantanamo. I mean, people say, you're keeping them without trial. Yeah? Why? Why are you bringing that up? Which, if you know international law and laws of armed conflict, you know why I answer it that way. Now, of course, what happens is, sorry, this is a very long answer. What happens is, because this has gone on so long, and it's kind of in a gray area, and it's a non-state actor, there is this gravitational pull to apply law enforcement principles to how it is we do what I think most of us in the room agree to be a law of armed conflict situation. And we work against ourselves, okay? Let me double down. I will go to Guantanamo. So I'm at Hay on Y for the thing, and I get interviewed by the BBC. And it was right after the president's kind of making noises, we're going to go to zero. Apparently that's not going to happen, but, you know, lots of questions. And they just asked me about the prisoners. Right? Would you keep Guantanamo open? Oh, sure. Whoa, why? Why? Well, because we're at war, and these are prisoners. We've got to keep them somewhere. And, well, but President Obama wants to close it. I said, well, look, we want to close it too. The Bush administration pushed more people out the door than the Obama administration. But the fact is, we're still a nation at war. And oh, by the way, and here's the punchline, sorry. The punchline was, oh, by the way, if President Obama gets his way and closes Guantanamo, he still will not have solved the problem. He will have people that he agrees are forever prisoners that will never be released and will never be tried. And all he has done is move them from a warm climate to a cold climate. But he will still have this irreducible number of people that we will insist keeping under the laws of armed conflict. So it's tough sledding. I have to tell you, I understand why the Brits Brexited. Okay, I think it's stupid. I think it's horrible. I think it's bad for Britain. I think it's worse for America. But I get the attitude because I've been hectored by the same European parliamentarians, okay, from some imagined moral high ground they thought they were on. And so I can understand the pushback. When you come back to them and kind of have this conversation, they just reject it out of hand. So you in the JAG Corps? Yeah. So good. I would not be bashful about defending our position. I would not be disrespectful to the opposition, which is honorable, but I do think we just need to kind of keep saying, well, you understand that. And by the way, Hamdan and Hamdi didn't help when Justice Stevens decided this was not a conflict of an international character. Kind of. Sorry, that's a secret joke between the lawyer and the guy who turns to the lawyer every day at CIA.
Afternoon, sir. Lieutenant Colonel Ted Scott, Seminar 22. Within the cyber realm, what is the event or set of events that keep you up at night, and what is the likelihood you think of that occurring?
Yeah, thanks. Great question. And I got another whole briefing I can give you on cyber. I just folded it into the first tectonic here, right? So here's where I am kind of on cyber, right? I frankly don't spend a lot of time waving my arms about cyber Pearl Harbors or cyber 9/11s. All right, I can't rule them out, but those who are waving their arms have to explain to me why they haven't been ruled in already. All right, so Leon Panetta succeeded me at CIA and then went on to be SecDef. He spent about the last year as Secretary of Defense really doing the cyber 9/11 thing. His last major speech was on the Intrepid in the Hudson River, talking about cyber 9/11. I don't go there. I mean, the way I put it is, if the Chinese are turning out the lights on the Eastern Seaboard, it's not the first thing the president's getting briefed on. There's a bunch of other stuff going on. This is a subset of that, right? Where I am now, where my, whoa, that could be pretty bad line, and my, whoa, that could actually happen line, right, is kind of at Sony North America Plus, okay? I'm kind of worried about the, not the mature nation state for whom actions have consequences, but the renegade, isolated, oh, what the hell, let's roll the dice, nation state, kind of permanent definition of North Korea, could include the Iranians if somehow the nuclear deal implodes. I can even imagine the Russians under high torque because of sanctions, okay, pulling off what you and I would call the high-end demonstration attack. Okay, you know what happened at Sony, right? Destroyed network, destroyed data, stole data, threatened physical harm, all right? And done by a nation state. Okay? I can see something like that, but it's more or less a kind of, you see this? Don't think that crap you're pulling is cost-free. I got options too. It's that kind of attack that I think the line, bad, likely, that's where it crosses. So that's the hook, but I'm taking one more. Thank you.
Hi, yes, sir. Lieutenant Colonel Rick Kimmel, Seminar 1. You mentioned in your Tectonic 1, to go back to that one, about failing states being more of a threat than the...
Powerful, yeah.
We seem to be going back to the future, I call it, where we're doubling down on more of our air, land, battle doctrine, force structure to fight existential threats better.
The near peer.
Near peer.
Yeah.
Do you see that the same way, or
yeah,
should we
yeah, I mean,
take another look at doubling down on that yeah, back to the future?
Sure. So I got four tectonics, right? And four is genuinely a nation state. And if we're going to do what I think we ought to do, we need to keep balancing their military power so that no one, not preparing for war, but balancing their military power so no one's tempted to go stupid 3, 5, 10, 15 years. And so that does require near peer, anti-access, aerial denial, counter stuff, high end, buy more F-35s kind of stuff. Sorry, just said that as an airman, okay? it does. You've got a little bit of that with the Russians, although I don't put the Russians in the same category as the Chinese. You know, the Chinese are rising, the Russians are revanchist. There's a difference, okay? But in addition, you do then have all these other flavor of threats. So if you kind of go through this, Tectonic 1 calls for non-traditional almost everything. Tectonic 2 calls for whole government because of the melting down of the international order. Tectonic 3 and 4 trend in the direction of more traditional expressions of military power. But unfortunately, I got them all. If you're asking me to rack and stack them, this might be a good way to end. So if I'm doing a chart here, I got my vertical and horizontal axis. Okay, down here, this is how bad could it be? This is how much time you got, okay? Down here are the kind of Tectonic 1 threats, okay? Cybercrime, cyber attack, transnational crime, terrorism. Bad could happen because a TSA agent makes a bad call tonight at Dulles. Existential, nah, not bad, okay? So that's immediate, but in degree of danger, I got worse. I come out that timeline 3, 5, 7, then I think I get the shot group of the ambitious, brittle, and nuclear. Okay, a revanchist Russia, whether the Iranians, North Koreans, Pakistanis, okay. Then I come out here, so it's further out, but higher. And then I come out here, 10 to 15, that's easy, that's China, all right? And that's way up here, as I said, that's pass-fail. You know, we're not going to make a mistake on that tonight. It's going to have catastrophic consequences. We've got time. So that's kind of how I people say, what's the worst thing out there? And I never answer the question. I go to this XY axis. Immediate, bad enough. Midterm, worse. Got some time. But this is the one we got to solve. Anyway, which then comes back to answer your question. Pretty much need all those capabilities, which is unfortunate from a taxpayer and national resource point of view. It's always a pleasure coming and chatting with you guys. I think I do a seminar after this, so I'll get a little more discussion in. Thanks so much. I appreciate those of you who picked up the book. I'm happy to sign if anybody's got some that you want a signature on. Thank you.